beginning in chapter 9 and verse 15. Hebrews 9, 15, through a bit of chapter 10. We'll pray together and ask God to open up the scripture to us now. Lord God, as we see the amazing transition you made from the typological worship to the true sacrifice of Jesus Christ on Calvary, may we have a deep reverence for what you have done for us, and that you have made sacrifice and cleansing real through the gift that was given to us on Calvary. In Jesus' name.
Morning.
Morning.
As Pastor Allen said, Hebrews 9, 15 through Hebrews 10, 10, you'll hear many times the Bible and through Allen's sermons that the Bible is the good news. Let me tell you, this chapter here that we're reading today, this is good news. Starting in verse 15, for this reason Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first commandment. Covenant. In the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it, because a will is enforced only when somebody has died. It never takes effect while the one who made it is living. This is why even the first covenant was not put into effect without blood. When Moses had proclaimed every commandment of the law to all the people, he took the blood of the calves, together with water, scarlet wool, and branches of hyssop, and sprinkled the scroll and all the people. He said, "This is the blood of the covenant which God has commanded you to keep." In the same way, he sprinkled with the blood both the tabernacle, and everything used in its ceremonies. In fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. It was necessary then for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again, the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood that is not his own. Then Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world. Now he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Just as man is destined to die once and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly, year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. If it could, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings you were not pleased." Then I said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God." First he said, "Sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not desire. nor were you pleased with them, although the law required them to be made. Then he said, Here I am. I have come to do your will. He sets aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all.
Well, last time we were together, we considered the full access that is given to us by the priestly work of Jesus Christ. You remember that veil inside the tabernacle and its later counterpart, the temple, that separated out the holy place from the Holy of Holies, in which only the high priest, only once a year, and not without the blood of another, could enter in. And we talked about how that veil was torn, allowing full access into God. Full access. Also, we talked about how the forgiveness that God gives us cleanses us right down to our very conscience. So, two very audacious things that we claim as Christians that we believe. We claim knowingly that I have full access into the Holy of Holies, the very presence of God, and I claim to have forgiveness so much so that I can feel it right down to my very conscience. Now, if you're going to make audacious claims like that, and I hope, by the way, every one of you can make such audacious claims, but if you're going to make such audacious claims, you're going to need a superior sacrifice. If you're going to have superior blessings, like we do in the New Covenant, you're going to need a superior sacrifice. So here's the question. What is it about Jesus that allows him to be such a superior priest, such a superior sacrifice over those Old Testament sacrifices that did not give full access, that did not give a clean conscience? Here's his first point. Through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God. An eternal Spirit was involved in this sacrifice. This probably does not refer to the Holy Spirit, but rather that eternal Spirit who was in the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, Jesus Christ. When you talk about any of Aaron's descendants who were the Aaronic priesthood, they had a spirit, but not an eternal spirit. There's a lot of nonsense that goes on today in the modern culture that tells you you had former lives. These are lies. That tells you you had pre-existence. That is a lie. The only one who ever walked the face of the earth in a human body who had a pre-existence was the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, previously, we also said that Jesus was given a true body formed in the womb of the Virgin Mary by the Spirit, and how his incarnation not only has significance on earth as he walked about and talked and told parables and taught and ultimately lays down his life, but his incarnation has ongoing significance in that his actual true body was raised, ascended to the Father's right hand in heaven above. Therefore, you, people below, have a representative in heaven above. But his Spirit was always existing with the Father. He is the eternal one from the beginning. Now, I ask you this somewhat rhetorical question. Do you want to believe you have full access? Do you want to feel clean right down to your very conscience? Then you need to understand the theology behind it, because if you're going to go out, believe me this, if you're going to go out in a world that does not believe, first of all, that we've sinned, why seek forgiveness? That does not know how to deal with guilt, has no concept of what it feels like to have a clean conscience. If you're going to go out in that sort of world and maintain audacious statements like, I've got full access, I've got a clean conscience before God, then you're going to need to understand the theology of the weight of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So what do we hear? We hear he offered an unblemished sacrifice, which was only typologically realized under the law. Under the law, we read this. This is the statute of the law the Lord has commanded. Tell the people of Israel to bring you a red heifer with which no blemish, on which a yoke has never come. Christ's humanity has already been brought forward. Remember we talked about last time how his body is likened unto a tabernacle. Now we see his emphasis turns towards his divinity. He is no mere man who has an eternal spirit. Christ's eternal spirit is meant as a contrast with the temporal animal sacrifices of that Old Testament system. So, if you want to have superior blessings, and believe me, I want superior blessings, do you not? I want a superior blessing. I don't want any lesser blessing. I want the biggest one God's got. Well, if I want the biggest blessing, I need the best sacrifice. And so I have a sacrifice who himself has an eternal spirit. We get a bit of election language here when it said that those who are called may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. The word called and chosen and elect are all part of that same root word. This corresponds with that Old Testament type of inheriting. Now, what was the emphasis of inheritance in the Old Testament? They were going to inherit the land of Canaan. Canaan was a real place, but Canaan itself held promises beyond earth. As they longed for a homeland, listen to the language, flowing with milk and honey. Can't you hear it? Flowing with milk and honey. God is calling their earthly desires higher. God had set them up to say, look, you want real blessings, I've got blessings, but not just of an earthly kind. To demonstrate that this is in keeping with our Reformed thinking, I'll quote from the Westminster Confession, chapter 8, verse 5. Listen to what I've already said. The Lord Jesus, by his perfect obedience and sacrifice of himself, which he through the eternal Spirit, there's our language, once offered up himself to God, has fully satisfied the justice of his Father, and purchased not only reconciliation, but an everlasting inheritance, there it is, in a kingdom of heaven, for all those whom the Father had given to him. This new mediator has ushered in a new covenant by his redeeming death. Now, does that sound, I don't know what to say, does that sound contradictory to you? A death that brings about life? But you know, this is Christianity 101. For example, here are a couple of passages. The Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, deliver us from this present evil age. And Peter wrote, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds we have been healed. So, if I'm reaching out to the first century Jewish Christian audience who is being tempted to return to the dead ceremonies of Judaism, what am I going to do? I'm going to say to them, look, this is not really anything different, but rather more fully revealed of God's plan than he'd always had. God had always been teaching you Jewish Christians that in order to have life, somebody's got to die. Did you hear the gospel? God had always been teaching them. And what does he say? What is meant when he says in verse 15, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant? His point there is that the death of Christ is so powerful that it has both a reverse effect to it as well as a forward effect to it. If you think of a timeline of history, you have Adam and Eve way up here, and then you have the cross, and then you have maybe 2018 here and forward. Jesus Christ's death comes right here. Jesus Christ's death is so powerful that it can reach backward into time to save those Old Testament saints who had only worshipped under the typological system. They did not understand the fullness of the gospel, which we do today. But Christ's sacrifice was powerful enough to reach back in time to save those Old Testament saints who were sacrificing only animals, as well as powerful enough to reach forward in time. This is exactly what is taught again in the confession. Although the work of redemption was not actually wrought by Christ till after his incarnation, think Bethlehem, yet the virtue, efficacy, and benefits thereof were communicated unto the elect in all ages, successively, from the beginning of the world, in and by those promises, types, sacrifices, in the morning responsive reading, Christ is revealed in the Old Testament. This was pointing to the Lord Jesus. Let's consider verses 16 through 22. He's now going to draw upon a legal illustration that you're all familiar with. I hope, at least if you are of age, and particularly if you are married, you have a last will and testament written. But it doesn't go in effect until you're dead. That's the point he's making. In order for a will to kick into force, somebody's got to die. And he goes on to cite events that happen in Exodus chapter 24. When Moses comes out of killing the animal, he says he sprinkled the people, the book of the law, and all the holy articles with blood. And his point is this. You Hebrew Christians who are being tempted to return to the dead ceremonies of Judaism, who are not sure about all this blood talk of Jesus, understand this. This is nothing new. This is what Moses did. Don't you remember when Moses came out and he purged the people? Consider what your favorite King David said when he wrote in Psalm 51. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Remember the last plague of Egypt? They killed the Passover lamb, and the head of the household was told to take a hyssop branch, dip it in the blood of the lamb, listen for the gospel, and paint the doorpost of your house so that everyone is in your house can be saved from the wrath of the death angel. You know, when I consider all this talk of blood and whose blood it is, I have a very deep reverence for the worship of God. I have no taste for, I have no desire for casual worship that calls nothing of me. I have no taste for it. And I'll tell you, this is the push in the modern church. The modern church is, give me a more casual, comfortable worship where nothing is required of me. Listen to me. A covenant that was not enacted but by a blood-dripping Son of God better call you to be reverent. Better call you to have a sense of fear and awe and holiness before God. A worship that says to you, just come and be casual. Just come and relax. I've got a blood-dripping Son of God walking down the Via Dolorosa, dragging a cross, and I'm supposed to think, oh, no big deal. I can't do it. And I can tell you there is an emotional, psychological, spiritual blessing with me feeling small in front of this holy God. Mr. Moral Man, be as moral as you can, but hear the thunder of God. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Mr. Ceremony Keeper, keep every ceremony as scrupulously as you would. Understand this. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So what do we say for the man on the street who's not really interested in being moral or keeping any ceremonies or in meeting Jesus? Understand this. He has no hope. There is no hope for the man that's not under the blood of the Lamb. How much hope did the Egyptians have who had not painted their doors? That's just an animal's blood. If they were killed for not coming under an animal's blood, what do you think God is going to do for those who will not come under the blood of the covenant that he paid with his own dear son? Let's consider verses 23 through 28. Under the law, there were earthly images that related to spiritual things. Those old covenant sacrifices were carnal, but they were also figurative. They pointed to different things. But the true worship that the earthly tabernacle had only typified requires more than the blood of beasts. Indeed, the true worship requires the precious blood of the Son of God. Let's consider this. What does Peter say? Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers. What is he talking about there? Futile ways. Futile ways would be those Old Testament sacrifices. Those Old Testament sacrifices ultimately were futile. They could not do for you what like silver and gold. All the ornamentation of that Old Testament worship, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Where have we heard that language? Our responsive reading, do you recall? When God gave that law concerning what type of sacrifice, he was pointing to the gospel. In the outer court, remember, it represents earth beneath. Well, here's my altar. Think cross. Think Calvary. The tent, the holy place here, which had a holy of holies concentrated in here, the priest would take the sacrifice from earth beneath, listen for the gospel, and he would take it into the holy place of heaven above. This is exactly what we have in Christ Jesus. What the former priest only typified under Old Testament worship systems has been realized in the person of Jesus Christ. So, going back to our original premise, do you want to know that you have full access? Boy, I do. Do you want to know that you've been forgiven right down to your very conscience? Boy, I do. If you're going to believe in an unbelieving world that you have superior benefits, superior rewards, I need a superior sacrifice. This is what he's saying, by the way, verse 24. Christ has entered not into the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true things, but into heaven itself, think inner tent, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Our author also wishes to distinguish between that Old Testament system and this in the New by saying that theirs was never finished. If you have to repeat, repeat, repeat the sacrifice, you know what you're saying? Not finished. What does Christ utter on the cross? I've done this with you before. It is finished. Remember his last statement on the cross? It is finished. All those typologies that had pointed to the cross are now done. This is what he's teaching, by the way, in verse 26 when he says, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by sacrifice of himself. This, by the way, is one of those contrasts between Catholic and Protestant positions. In the Catholic position, what they call the Mass, which is somewhat equivalent to what we call the Lord's Supper or Communion, they see it as an ongoing re-sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is offensive to Protestants, largely out of this passage, because in our understanding of what the Bible teaches is that the sacrifice is done, never to be repeated. That's why I can believe it is a superior sacrifice. Calvin writes, the papists take so much delight, for they say that the sacrifice of Christ on the cross was bloody, but the sacrifice of Mass, which they pretend to offer daily to God, is unbloody. I care nothing that ancient writers have spoken thus, for it is not in the power of men to invent sacrifices as they please. Stands the truth declared by the Holy Spirit that sins are not expiated or taken away by the sacrifice except the blood be shed. Therefore, the notion that Christ is often offered is a device of the devil. They are guilty of offering him an atrocious insult who seek to renew his sacrifice as though the things were not complete by his death. You see, every man, every woman has an appointment with the judgment seat of Christ. And we are told that we are like grass that withers, flowers that fade. You're a vapor, you're a dust in the wind, and you are admonished not to boast about tomorrow. So we cannot live carelessly. Listen, every single one of us are one heartbeat away from appearing in the presence of Almighty God, whose standard of his law will more thorough than you'd ever fear. I'll tell you the truth. I would rather die 1,000 deaths than to show up in the courtroom of God saying, God, look at all my morality. I would rather die 1,000 deaths than to show up in the courtroom of God and say, God, look at all the ceremonies I've kept. I tell you, there's one thing that gives me peace. To know that I could die today, I could die tomorrow, why? It's because I have a better sacrifice in Jesus Christ. He goes on to tell us that he's coming a second time, not to deal with sin, but for those who are eagerly awaiting him. Remember the 10 virgins? 5 were wise, 5 were foolish, 5 old and trimmed their lamps, and when the knock of the bridegroom came, they were happy. They were eagerly awaiting. Christian, I tell you the truth, that's the position you should be in right now. If you have the oil of the Holy Spirit in your lamp, if you are under the blood of Jesus Christ, you ought to be eagerly and happily awaiting his second coming. What does Paul teach concerning these things? Wait for the Son from heaven, who is raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. We see the unwillingness to acknowledge our Lord's return among many people. Most of the unbelieving world don't spend a lot of time mocking the heavenly reign of Jesus Christ. Why is that? Well, they can't see it. They're too ignorant to consider it. So where does the rage and anger of unbelieving people, where is it aimed? It's aimed at the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ, because at least they can see that. I want you to consider what that says about human beings, that people would rage against a ministry as kind as Jesus was, who showed only kindness, only compassion, only genuine love. From the rich young ruler who walked away because he thought he had many possessions, to the woman taken in the very act of adultery, to thieving, tax collecting Zacchaeus, to Judas, who when he came to Jesus to betray him, Jesus said, "Friend, why have you come?" And the world rages against this kind Savior? Yes. And amazingly, that says a whole lot more about us than we'd like to admit. A man who demonstrated this much love was a walking reflection of all the perfections demanded by the law that you could not keep. I'm going to say that again. The reason people rage against Jesus Christ is he is a walking reflection of all the perfections demanded by the law of God that you could not keep. Therefore, he exists as a painful reminder of our undoneness. But instead of bowing to King Jesus, you know what most people do? They rage against King Jesus. That's not going to work. Also in verse 10, or chapter 10, I should say, he again makes the point, repeated sacrifice speaks to undoneness or incomplete. From Leviticus 16, the priest, he shall make atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make atonement for the tent of the meeting, for the altar, and he shall make atonement for the priest, for all the people of the assembly. And this shall be a statute forever for you, that atonement may be made for the people, for Israel, once in the year, because of all their sins, and Aaron did as the Lord commanded. Again, his argument's very easy to follow. Repeated sacrifice, it's good in this sense. It's good in the sense that it reminds you of your sin. But you know what else it lets us in on? It's not powerful enough to take away your sin. Otherwise, why would he keep doing it? His second argument is also easy to follow. The blood of bulls and goats can't take away sins. His argument's very easy to follow. The lesser cannot pay for the greater. Only the greater can pay for the lesser. Animals, which are lesser, under the dominion of mankind, according to what God said to Adam. Adam had dominion over the animals. The lesser cannot pay for the greater. Who do we need? If I want to have a greater blessing, and I've already admitted to you, I want a greater blessing, I need a greater sacrifice. Greater than a bull or a goat or a heifer. Verses 5 through 7. This is a curious little passage, and I'm going to have to do some explaining to you. This passage is difficult because he quotes from Psalm 40, which in the Hebrew reads this way. Sacrifice and offering you have not delighted, but you've given me an open ear. The New Testament quotes that you've given me a body. In the original Hebrew, in the Masoretic text, it reads, you've given me an open ear. Now, this could mean a couple of different things. If I say, I've got an open ear to you, it's about the equivalent of me saying my heart is open to you. I'm listening to what you're saying. God, you give me an open ear. And you know what that means. It can also be translated, you have dug out my ear. Okay? If that's the case, it probably is referring to the Old Testament practice. If you were a Hebrew slave or servant, and your time of freedom has come up, you're 7 years of up, your debt is paid, you're ready to go, but you don't want to go. Perhaps your master still owns your wife. Perhaps he still owns your children. Perhaps you just love him and want to stay. What they would do is they would take you to the doorpost and bore a hole in your ear. That symbolized your willingness to stay with your master. Okay. So, whether the passage refers to I have an open ear, I'm listening to you, or whether it refers to I'm a servant who has willingly bore a hole in his ear to signify my submission to you, either way it means about the same thing. I have willingly chosen to submit myself to you. Now, the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, does have the word body. You have prepared a body. And this apparently is what our Hebrew author is quoting when he quotes Psalm 40. He says, you prepared a body for me. That was done in the womb of the Virgin Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit. God's pleasure had not so much been in the sacrifice itself, but in the reverencing of the worshiper. What does he say in verse 7? I delight to do your will, O God. Yea, your law is within my heart. Thus, the nature of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has what? An eternal spirit and a prepared body. What does he live his life doing? Delighting to do the will of the Father. I would challenge anyone, any Torah, to bring forward anyone in all of recorded history who is more delighted to do God's will. Moses, I want you to go back to Egypt and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. You got the wrong man. I don't want to do it. I stutter. Pick somebody else. I don't care who else. Jesus Christ, go to the cross. Yes, Father. I'll go to the cross. Tell me who in history, prophet, philosopher, sage, ceremony keeper, who more than Jesus Christ has delighted to do the will of his Father? For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up at the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So let's wrap it up with this. Do you wish to have that fuller access to God than those Old Testament saints ever could? Do you wish to know that you're forgiven right down to your very conscience forgiven? Because these are rather outlandish sets of beliefs. Full access to God? A perfectly clean conscience for a God like this, then you're going to need a superior sacrifice. One who has an eternal spirit, one who has a true body fashioned by God himself, and that's what you have in the gospel. You can believe audacious rewards because you got an audacious Savior. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you can tell, Pastor Flowers loves to preach the good news. It is my great joy to tell you how much Jesus loves you and how awesome Jesus is. Let's pray together. Father, we want to bask in the excitement of having full access and a clean conscience. We want to rest on that perfect sacrifice you've given to us as your people. And so, Lord God, send out your with the full joy of knowing what you've accomplished in your sacrifice on Calvary. In the name of Jesus our Lord, amen. Would you stand to receive God's blessing? Tonight again, we'll be looking at Hosea. I invite you back for the preaching of God's word. Now I bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in the peace, and the love, and the joy that God grants to all of his people.